Thank you very much, Mike. Thank you, Deborah. And like Deborah and Mitch, I want to express my gratitude to Roger and to Mike and to Jonathan and Francesca for the opportunity to be a part of this. It was a terrific experience for all of us, and we're all grateful. I'm going to bring closure to the panel part of this discussion by focusing on two dimensions of the report. The first, Mike alluded to, the role of higher education in a democracy. And the second is the place of higher education in a more complex context as we move forward into an uncertain future. And there's, as Mike highlighted, the three most important elements of the report: the focus on the quality of what is experienced on our campuses, completion and affordability are the driving messages. There is a fourth section, and I'm just going to speak briefly to the elements of that fourth section, which is a bit more speculative looking forward. But first, a word about the role of higher ed in a democracy. I think we all recognize that higher education in America has always had a role in preparing an engaged citizenry. From the days of our founding, there was a recognition embodied, for example, in the lives and work of Franklin and Jefferson, of the importance of deep learning for sustaining our form of government. And the report is very explicit, and Mike made reference to this in his introductory comments. While we want to ensure that the experience, that high quality of experience that each of our students has on our campuses, is ensuring the conditions for personal human flourishing, and at the same time, ensuring that they have the skills, the preparation necessary to compete in an ever-evolving economic context. We want to ensure that they have the personal skills and the practical skills. We're also clear, again, in Mike's words, the civic capacities that will enable our students to be engaged citizens. The same knowledge and skills that are identified in the report that are required to ensure lives of flourishing and of participation in the workforce are the skills for sustaining a vibrant democracy. And there's a segue now between this point and then the four key lenses that are presented in this fourth section, which we call the Further Future Considered, which really takes a look at what might be required of our young people as they accept their responsibilities for leadership in the world. And the four lenses, the first focuses on the role and the responsibility we have to social cohesion. And you see the natural segue to this, to an engaged citizenry, the recognition that what we are experiencing today on our campuses, the yearning for inclusion, that sense of belonging, the need to find the ties that bind us together as a people, the work we need to engage in to create a more perfect union. This work of social cohesion is the work of citizens. And it's a part of our responsibility to ensure that we're preparing young people for the responsibility of citizenship. The second lens focuses on the future needs and characteristics of the workforce. As technology impacts the future of work, as we see ever new kinds of requirements for the participants in the workforce, we have all kinds of scenarios that have been painted for us, from the most optimistic to the most dystopian. The question is, what will be demanded of our young people as they enter a changing, evolving, and more complex economy? And the third, with the explosion of these new technologies, the incredible data that's available, the new means and access to knowledge, with increasing transparency and unprecedented access, what are the skills and talents that will enable our young people to harness these resources for the common good? And then the final lens is the potential global challenges we need to anticipate, ranging from climate change to access to food, water, and energy, the universal need for more education. I think at the heart of this report, is there any possible scenario in which the knowledge and skills identified in this report will not be even more valuable when you look through the lens of these four forces. The changing nature of our economy throughout our history has always required a more educated workforce. The structure and design of work, the jobs for which they need to be prepared will change, but will we ever need less talent? Can we imagine a future in which our children will not need more skills, abilities, talents, and capacities than what we have today? Again, our ever-expanding digital lives will bring new pressures on the character and quality of our interpersonal interactions. Will our children have the capacity for intimacy? And the challenges of a vulnerable planet demand stronger institutions and a more prepared and engaged citizenry. So I think these four forces that we identify in this last section of the report can contribute to a future we can dream of for our children, or they can create a dystopia that we would not wish to bequeath to them. Can we harness these forces to ensure the flourishing of each of our children? Can we strengthen the common good of the communities in which they will be contributing? As our report states, our democracy has always entailed a compact among the generations, in which each generation has accepted some responsibility for the success of the next. This report is a call for us to recognize our responsibility for future generations, and the most important steps we can take is to ensure the undergraduate education available in the future will be a worthy legacy for our generation, from our generation to the next. Thank you.